This lecture has been, I was asked to give this lecture a couple of days ago, almost when I was not in Delhi but Lucknow. And I didn't know exactly what to do, how to pitch it, because I didn't know what the audience was going to be. But then I decided it doesn't make much of a difference because it's about real life. It's not about the frontiers of science. It's something to do with you, though. It's something to do with this generation which is sitting on some kind of a spike, what is called a cusp. See, what's happening is that there's so much going on and so many things that are coming into our lives. You know, cell phones, PlayStations, everything. You know, the human body is becoming burdened by many, many things now. Everybody has to have, each one of us has to have one of each. But this is posing a bit of a problem because it's downloading a lot of waste on the planet, like electronic waste, like toxic waste. And you all know what has happened. In India particularly, if you go to any of our rivers, either they don't run, or if they run, they run with sewage. Right? And you expect something is going to happen because our Prime Minister says we are going to do something. But you know, even at the age of whatever, 14, 15, that nothing's going to happen in a hurry. Because it took a long time to spoil them, it's going to take a longer time to fix them. But you can't really fix them. Because these are kind of resources which are evolutionary resources. You know, if you take a river like the Ganga or the Yamuna, it was built after the Himalayas started 55 million years ago. Maybe it's been running for 30 million years ago. And that's how much time it took to make a river. So now you don't know what's going to happen to these rivers. And the life in these rivers is never going to come back because it took 30 million years of evolution to make the life in the river. But there is something that's happened in science, and it has not to do with science as such, but how science is used. That in the last 50 years, let me start off with one thing. That recently there was a report published by the World Wildlife Fund. And the report, 5 years ago, the report said that about 30% of the species on this planet were close to extinction. This report, after 5 years, says that 52.5% of the species on the planet are extinct. Now, whether correct or not correct, it is actually an approximate, it's actually somewhat close to the truth. So, just to tell you, 74% of all the species in the rivers of the world have disappeared. And 40% of the species in the sea have disappeared, including all the big sharks and the whales. And 40% of the species on land have disappeared. Now, if you look at the planet, it's interesting how the planet works. You must have asked yourself the question. Have any of you asked yourself the question how you work? I mean, your body temperature, right? I mean, when you go home, I don't know, your mother, probably, more likely than your father, is going to ask you if you say you're not well, if you have fever. So what happens? You have something like, I think people are used to centigrade now, 37.8 degrees centigrade. And if it goes up by a degree, then you know you're not well. Have you ever asked yourself the question, when you have a blood test and something goes wrong in that blood test, the plasma, the blood plasma that you have, the trace elements that you have, how does the body manage to keep itself in this steady state where the temperature, the pressures, everything is kept in a completely steady state? And if you go a little bit off, you get sick. If you go a little bit more off, then you get very sick. And if you get a little bit more off, then you're out of this world. You're not there anymore. Have you asked yourself the question how this works? I want to know an answer from the people here. The students particularly. Did you ever ask yourself the question how this miracle happens? Okay, nobody's saying anything. Maybe we'll move it to the question session. Okay. So if you ask yourself questions like that, then to maintain this steady state is not an easy thing. And we don't know. It's called homeostasis. We have a word for it, but we don't have an explanation for it. We don't even know how a single cell works. However, the same thing happens at the level of the planet. The planet has been kept in a steady state for a long time. Of course, we've had ice ages, we've had extinctions, but that's over millions and millions of years. The planet, by and large, otherwise, is in a steady state. So what keeps the air on this planet constant, you know, 20% oxygen or 21%, 78% nitrogen, 0.003% carbon dioxide? And the whole climate debate, global warming, is about carbon dioxide going from 0.003% to 0.004%. It's going to change the face of this world. I suppose some of you must be reading about this in the newspaper or in class. So the planet has also been keeping a steady state. Now how does it do that? For example, in seawater, the salt content of seawater is 3.4% by weight, and it's remained that way for over 2 billion years, or 3 billion years, which is 3/4 of the age of the planet. But how has it been possible? Because all the time salt is being washed into the oceans. So somewhere the salt must be going out. Okay? We'll come to that later. Now, you know how this works in nature. Supposing we have a carbon atom today, you all had some lunch today, I presume, and you had some sabzi. I don't know, spinach, bhindi, whatever, lauki. So you had a lot of carbon atoms today. Tomorrow some of them will go out. We don't have to go into details. You know how they go out. Okay? And in a few days they might be part of the soil. It's called night soil, but then it finally becomes day soil also. And it goes back. It keeps cycling. The atom keeps cycling all the time. But the interesting thing about life is that this cycling means that there is no waste on the planet. Okay? Everything that we have, the plants die, we might die, all the decomposition is done, we are built out of all those carbon atoms. I'm just taking one example. And then the carbon dioxide goes back into the atmosphere and it starts goes into photosynthesis and starts becoming plant matter again. So there's no waste on the planet, and this is a natural cycle. There's a natural cycle for each element. The other ones are not. Nitrogen is well known, carbon is known, phosphorus is known, it's in trouble. Most of the others you don't hear about, at least in school, and mostly in college and university either. And each of them, everything has to be recycled. How is it done? Well, there are hundreds of species that carry this out, and millions and millions of bacteria which do this. There's a whole network of all the life, from insects to bacteria to species, which does all this. That network is going on all the time. Okay? Now, what will happen? I'm not going to go on because I have about 45 minutes and I have to explain a few things to you. What will happen if 52% of the species that we know, we don't know about the bacteria, if 52% of the species that we know have already been extinguished? So something is wrong in the way that science is being used, or technology, which comes out of science. Okay? As I said, each one has one of each, a computer, a cell phone, a headphone, a whatever system. You don't need all these things, you know, but they're multiplying and they're thrown away after 2 years because you get a new one. So the consumption that has gone on in the last 50 years is so great that 50% of the species and 1/3 of the entire living resource of the planet has got finished. So we don't want to come to such a nasty end, right? So we want to do something about it. And that's what actually I am going to tell you, a couple of things that we can do about it. So first I'm going to show you a small movie. This was just an introduction to tell you why I'm doing this. It's not that there's anything wrong with science. Science is about knowledge and it's about the known. But when you consider the whole life on the planet, a lot is known. After all, we were told by Mr. Dharamveer that there are some great incredible medical techniques and all kinds of sensors and things that are happening. But there's infinitely more that is unknown. And if you are interested in life, you don't know how to deal. Science does not know how to deal with the unknown. And to deal with the unknown, you need this natural wisdom that I was talking about natural cycles, about species, biodiversity, which enables you to have natural cycles. That enables you to have a steady state and give you your mangoes every day, give you your vegetables every day, give you your grain every day. Okay? So there's a lot more going on that is outside of science, and so you need some wisdom. And what we are talking about is how we can put this wisdom into science. And believe you me that it has not been done. So I thought it is about time. You people are all very young. You're going to come face to face with it even more than us. Daily problems in daily life, water is going to run out, air is going to become bad, everything is happening, the forests are disappearing, the floods are going to come. So we have to do something that we can get out of this jam that we put ourselves in. So I'm going to start with a small movie on water, and then I'll take 10 minutes to tell you about a couple of water solutions, okay? If that's all right. I thought it would be nice to see a movie.
55 million years ago, the Himalayas were formed and the Yamuna started flowing. Each year, the river flooded its banks and left behind its legacy of sand, making the floodplains. This has become the invaluable inheritance of our city. Mineral water is rich in nutrients and trace elements that we all need. All these natural resources, like glaciers, rivers, original forests, are created by millions of years of evolution. Their loss is irreversible. Life is intrinsically linked to natural resource through evolution. But we are losing them very fast. The Millennium Report says that over 50% of the world's ecosystems are showing terminal loss. And the population in India has become almost four times what it was at independence. We cannot go the American way. Compared to India, America has 12 times more natural resource per person. Now for a little bit of magic. In one of the glasses is Yamuna sand. This is the same sand that populates the floodplains of the Yamuna, which are 100 square kilometers large and 40 meters deep. And now you will see how much water this sand can hold. So I begin here with a glass of water which has exactly the same level of water as the sand, and I begin to fill up the sand with water. You can see the water darkening, the sand darkening where the water is coming in. So we are gradually getting to the bottom of the glass. The water is percolating through the sand. You can see that it is percolating quite fast. So you see, if you compare the levels of the two glasses, that at least 50% of the water has soaked into the sand. And this is exactly what the Yamuna floodplain can do for you. If dredged with monsoon discharge water, this 100 square kilometers, which is 40 meters deep, can fill half its volume with water. That is about 2 billion cubic meters. And out of that you can extract half of that amount, which is called the specific yield. That's about a billion cubic meters, and that is very close to what the Jal Board supplies Delhi today. So this is just to illustrate to you how valuable this top sand layer of 40 meters on the Yamuna floodplains is. This picture gives you the actual profile of the river Yamuna. The light colored section on top is the sandy layer of the Yamuna. It varies from 80 meters below ground on the left to 30 meters over part of some of the other sections. The giant aquifer that you have just seen, which is the floodplain of the river Yamuna, can yield about 900 million cubic meters of water every year. We have five times this amount, about 4 billion cubic meters, going out as monsoon discharge from June to September each year. So we have the storage in the floodplain and we have the water to recharge it every year. How do we do this? Earlier, in the 60s, for example, we had floods every year. Now we don't. Once in 10 years, the last one was in 1995. A simple scheme will do this for us. If we embank the area between two successive barrages and open the upstream barrage, close the downstream one, and let the water flow to fill up the embanked floodplain area with about 2 feet of water for a few days till it saturates. We now have a fully water-charged floodplain ready for use. In the water-scarce summer months, April to June, we can draw out the water using tube wells. In July, as the monsoon discharge comes in, we can again recharge the floodplain. This scheme is preserve and use, non-invasive use of a phenomenal natural resource. The Shanghai area in China is spending a staggering $6 billion to recycle water for 25 million people. In recycled water, quality also suffers. We have given a scheme where we can service 3/4 of Delhi's 17 million population with fresh monsoon water for free. Whether we value this water at current market rates for tankers or recycling cost, it is worth 9,000 crores of water a year on this day. But actually, it is forever to preserve and to use. This is huge and important for the life of the city. Water harvesting all of the rooftops in the city of Delhi and the NCR can provide for only 5% of this, and it is expensive in terms of infrastructure. Encroachments go on unabated, not entirely out of ignorance. The present and future generations must know what they are losing. This, what you see before you, is our local goddess, the Yamuna, today. We can treat and clean all the city discharge that goes into the sacred river. And as we have shown, the goddess Yamuna can be restored and be the savior of our city. So we now know that the floodplain is such an invaluable resource. It is then essential that all of us make the government enact a law that totally stops any further building on the floodplain immediately. Schools, colleges, foundations, and media have a very major role to expedite this. It is very promising that the Lieutenant Governor, as chairman of the Prime Minister's Committee on the Yamuna, has asked the Central Groundwater Board to prepare a blueprint for this scheme. This is indeed a very progressive step. This is only a beginning. All of India's rivers need to be preserved for the future. They are literally crying out for it. Your life depends essentially on this water. The time is now. Otherwise, they shall be all gone. We ask you for a small contribution to adopt and protect a small part of the floodplain from encroachment and pollution. If you need help, please contact us.
Cities can be completely serviced by floodplain water, and floodplain water is very, very, very good. It's not the same quality as river, because it is the rain which is coming down, which is unpolluted, that's recharging this wide floodplain. Floodplain of the Yamuna is at least 6-10 kilometers. The Brahmaputra is 30 kilometers, and the flood water which comes late in the season. So when you dig a well and take out the water, you find the water quality is very good, and you don't need to recycle. But this movie was a very old movie, because at that particular time we were just looking at what it was. And if you want to be very, very careful, non-invasive is the word, then you shouldn't use more water than is recharged every year. So I'm going to take a little more time just to show you how these solutions come about, how you can make non-invasive solutions, okay? So the movie was just to show you what was going on over there. So I'm going to jump across here. You have seen all this. You've seen this also. So let's look at this. So what is the floodplain? There's something very special about the floodplain. You know, the floodplain is at least 5 kilometers wide, and it runs for thousands of kilometers, and mostly for Himalayan rivers, it's 100 meters deep. And it's not half of it which is water, because of gravity, only about 35-40% of it, 35-40%. So it is the most natural and best aquifer system that we have. And nobody in the world has used it. So all this research was everything that we just did in 4-5 years in Delhi, because we thought it was a great idea. Many rivers don't have these floodplains. The European rivers don't. They don't even have a water problem. But China, India, Middle East, that is where you can use this in hundreds of cities, for example. Okay, then the quality, I already told you, is very, very good. But where you have to be careful is, you must not use more than the water that's recharged every year. That is the most important thing. That's what you must learn. I think all our forefathers knew about this. never push the earth to balding. Never push it so hard that exploit it. Only use what it gives you back every year. Okay? Only use that much. And you have to work that out. That takes a fair amount of research to do because it has not been done. So we worked out what it could, and that's why the estimate, what I said, we came to 1/3 of that for Delhi. But if you look at the Mahanadi, do you all know where the Mahanadi is in Katak in Bhubaneswar, Odisha? It gets 3 times the amount of rainfall as Delhi. And that river can give you water for 5 million people without a problem. Although there are only 2.5 million people there. Delhi, of course, is too big, so it can't be watered by this. But so many other cities can be. Okay? And when the river rises in the flood at peak flood, it is about 4 meters higher. So the water starts going, the river becomes from say 80 meters, it becomes almost a kilometer wide, and the water goes to both sides and fills up the floodplain. But still, in Delhi, you won't be able to get more than 250 million cubic meters, good for about 3-4 million people in a year. So here's a solution. Okay, you can use it every year. All you need is a grid of tube wells. And after that, if you want to remove them, you can remove them. The floodplain will remain as it is. We changed the idea of doing any engineering. Because the moment human beings start working with a place, they finish it off. So let it naturally recharge and just naturally store water. And we can do this just by having a grid of tube wells. Okay, so why is it non-invasive? If it's non-invasive, it will last you year after year after year, generation after generation after generation. Now what have they done in Delhi and what have they done in Tamil Nadu? They've actually done sand mining in Tamil Nadu where the river is only 20 meters deep and 10 meters of sand has been taken out by the building lobby. Now they don't have water. In Delhi, the Noida aquifer and Greater Noida, they've done so much building that Noida for 30 years got water from the aquifer between the two most polluted rivers, Hindan and Yamuna, because the polluted water doesn't come in even. But now they've overexploited it and the water has started coming in. So once the resource is finished, it's finished. So what I'm trying to say is you have to be very careful about making sure that your intervention when you use science is non-invasive. That's all I wanted to say. Now I want to give you one more little instance of a solution. And usually you work on these solutions wherever you are. I mean, if you're in Chandigarh, there's no river here. So you can't do it. But if you're in a city which has a river, you can do it. But in Chandigarh, you can do something else. Okay, so we'll come to that in a moment. Okay, now I don't want to... This you should remember. We are trying to give you some solutions which will make you go on year after year, as I said, in a non-invasive way. Okay? Now, I want to do one more little explanation, which you can do in Chandigarh. In Delhi, we have something called the Delhi Ridge, which is an Aravalli forest area. Most of you don't know that the Aravallis are 50 times older than the Himalayas. And they came all the way from Antarctica with Gondwana land when the Indian plate came and bumped into the Asian plate to make the Himalayas. So they're very old, but they have a forest and it's a thorn forest and Delhi doesn't get very much rain. It gets much less rain than Chandigarh, 60 centimeters in a year. But now I want to go back to say that what is a spring? Have you all had mineral water? You must have had at some point. Himalayan mineral water. Okay, Himalayan mineral water, if you go and buy it today in the city in Chandigarh, it will cost you 48 rupees or could be 50 rupees. For 1 liter. This is not mineral water. This is water which is sold is reverse osmosis water, which has all the good nutrients and trace elements taken out of it. That's why mineral water sells for 50 rupees. a liter. Now, what is mineral water? Have you ever thought? What happens up in the mountains? It's supposed to come from the Himalayas. Rain falls on the forest, and there's leaf matter, humus. It picks up nutrients from the humus, goes down through the rock, and comes out in a spring. It picks up minerals from the rock. So what happens is that the minerals and the nutrients come in that water. And that is the water that our system is used to. Till 50 years ago, everybody was drinking such water. Like everybody was eating organic food. But now, we can't drink it because we polluted all the water, so we have to drink water like this, which is 12 rupees or 10 rupees a liter. Now, how do you get this mineral water locally? Well, you have the Shivaliks in Chandigarh, we have the ridge in Delhi. It's a forest. Now, take this forest, the rain falls on it, and it goes down, and it goes and fills up the aquifer underground. It doesn't come out in a spring, but it settles underground. If you find the aquifers, you need 2 or 3 liters a day. So if you need water for about 3 million people, it's very easy to get it from your local forest. And you can dispense it from, you know, mother dairy outlets, just put the water on top, pay 4 rupees, everybody, and it's a huge health benefit and gives you an enormous economic benefit. Because if you can't show that you get some, you're making some money out of it, nobody listens anymore. So you can get health benefit, you can get economic benefit, and you go local and you make your own mineral water. So you people can start doing that right now. Because if you don't do it, then those areas will also go away. You make them into a water sanctuary. So that's what I've just tried to indicate over here. I've given you only 2 solutions, because you people are rather young. There are many things that we work on. We work on cities, we work on energy, but it has to be non-invasive. Like energy, solar energy in Ladakh, which gets 300 clear days a year. You can do something over there that is very non-invasive and gives you an enormous amount of solar energy, about 9 times what you get in Germany. You can also make cities in a way that they are self-sustaining. Okay? Not smart cities. You know, everybody is very smart and uses a lot of cosmetics, and then you make a mess out of everything. But healthy cities which are self-sustaining. So what I was trying to move you, I said the talk is about you, it's not about the frontiers of the universe, you'll have talks about that too. But how to change your scheme of living now, so that you people actually can at least find that you can get into a healthy life. And if we don't do it, you can do as much science and technology as you want, but all you're going to be doing is surviving, barely surviving, till you come to an end. And so I should end with that, because I have a signal from there to come to an end. Thank you.
Good evening, sir. My question is that the underground water all contains the required amount of minerals, which is good for our body. And if it does not exceed the limit of minerals, then it may be healthy for our body. But why you are saying that the forest water can produce only the mineral water?
I haven't quite understood your question, but if you just get water locally here, right? Yeah. Then firstly, supposing you dig a well right here. Then firstly, you will have pollution from the city, because there's a lot of sewage in the city that goes there. You can have also industrial pollution, and you will not have the right nutrients. And then it doesn't go through any kind of rock formation. So sir, these are the things, that is why people get this water from mountains and forests.
Sir, actually mountains, the water we obtain from the mountains contain the remains or the minerals of the humus. But if we get the underground water, it contains necessary ionic salts, etc. And from food, we already obtain the organic matter, which we will obtain from the humus through the forest water.
No, I haven't. I don't know what to answer to your question. I already answered your question. If you get the water from the river of the floodplain, it will not be mineral water. Because this water now is just coming, as I said, that if you go to that garden over there and you get the water, it will have all kinds of pollution in it. Yeah. And it will also not have the right amount of minerals. But if you go to a forest and get the water, then it has most of the things that you need, okay, underneath it.
I understand. Okay, sir. Thank you.
Sir, I'm also belongs to Agra Sen, and I'm समय रोजाना अपने आगरा में यमुना नदी को देखता हूँ सर. मैं सोचता हूँ कि आपने जितना बताया मैं बहुत इंस्पायर हुआ उससे, पर मैं सोचता हूँ कि एज ए सिविलियन मैं एक आम स्टूडेंट के तौर पर क्या कर सकता हूँ, क्योंकि सर मैं देखता हूँ कि मेरे घर के बगल से बालू निकाले आते हैं नदियों से, इतना कुछ होता है और सर कुछ होता कुछ
कोई पास रखिए, थोड़ा पास रखिए
सर. जो नदियों से बालू निकाला जाता है, अब मैं खुद यमुना नदी के बगल से रहता हूँ तो देखता हूँ कि बालू निकालता कोई कुछ करता भी नहीं है, होता भी नहीं है. और जितना मुझे मालूम है कि बारिश जो निकालने का होता है कुछ लिमिटेड टाइम के लिए होता है, पर उसमें कुछ नहीं पूरे ईयर बालू निकाला जाता है. तो सर मैं भी कुछ सोचता हूँ इसके लिए, पर आज का आपका देखा तो पहले पूछ लिया सर.
देखिए अभी ये जो आपने यमुना की स्कीम बताई है, ये दिल्ली का जल बोर्ड है, उसमें ये स्कीम टेंडर हो चुकी है. तो दिल्ली में करीब 15 लाख लोगों के लिए पानी यहाँ से फ्लड प्लेन से निकलेगा. जब लोगों को इतना समझ आ जाएगा, जब ऐसी चीज़ चल जाएगी, तब तो उसका मूल्य समझ आ जाएगा लोगों को. जब मूल्य समझ आ जाएगा तब वो किसी को नहीं करने देंगे. जो आपको ये समझ आ जाए, तो जैसे आपकी पीढ़ी है ना, आप अभी तो यंग हैं, हमारे जैसे नहीं, तो आपको ये समझ आ जाए कि ये आप आगे का आपका पानी चोर रहे हैं, आप अपने सब दोस्तों को बताइए, उसके बाद आप वहाँ पे जाके आप चाहे उनके यहाँ पे आंदोलन करिए, जो कुछ भी करिए कि आप हमारी पीढ़ी का पानी चोर रहे हैं, तो उसके बाद वो बंद हो जाएगा. पर आपको ये करना पड़ेगा, क्योंकि साइंस का मतलब ये है कि आपको समझ आना चाहिए कि अब परिस्थिति जो है, अभी जो हालात हैं, उसमें पानी कहाँ से आएगा. तो हम ये आपको बता रहे हैं साइंस के माध्यम से कि वो पानी एक जगह पे है, अभी वो दुनिया में इस्तेमाल नहीं हुआ है, ऐसी स्कीम अभी यूज़ नहीं हुई है. अब इस स्कीम के ऊपर आप काम करें और ऐसे करें कि ये स्कीम से नुकसान नहीं पहुंचे. तो आपको इसके लिए थोड़ा बहुत झगड़ना पड़ेगा. आप अपने माँ बाप से बात करिए, उनसे कहिए कि पब्लिक इंटरेस्ट लिटिगेशन करें, कुछ तो करना पड़ेगा ना. पहले साइंस का तो इतना मतलब बनता है कि आपको समझा दें कि भाई इसमें क्या मूल्य है, इसमें क्या गुण है. अच्छा,
ओके सर, थैंक यू.
सोनी सर, मैं ये जानना चाहता हूँ, जैसे अपने मोस्ट ऑफ द एग्जांपल्स दिल्ली के लिए, क्या अगर इन्हीं एग्जांपल्स को इंडिया के बिहाफ पे लिया जाए तो स्टोरी कैन बी डिफरेंट.
नहीं, ये थोड़ा सा मैंने बताया आपको कि जहाँ भी नदी है, और ये भी नहीं ज़रूरी है कि वो नदी बारह मास चलती रहे, जहाँ भी नदी है वहाँ पे ही हो सकता है, क्योंकि आप नदी के पास जाएंगे आपको हमेशा रेत मिलेगी. वो रेत जो है, वो रेत में पानी ये जमा हो जाता है. तो और दूसरी चीज़ है कि ये जो रेत के अंदर पानी होता है, अब मैं आपको एक मथुरा की छोटी सी कहानी बताऊं. हम मथुरा गए एक बार, तो हम लोगों को खाना खाना था, क्योंकि करीब एक बज गया था. तो एक छोटा सा अंदर जाके होटल देखा, तो उनसे पूछा हमने भाई कि घर वाला खाना खिलाओगे, तो कहने लगे साहब क्यों नहीं खिलाएंगे. तो उन्होंने हमने कहा हम ये ज़्यादा तेल वेल और फ्राई खाना नहीं खा सकते. तो फिर हमने कहा अच्छा, अब पानी पीना है हमें, तो पर हम कैसा पानी है आपका. तो कहता है हमारा पानी तो अच्छा है. तो मैंने कहा यमुना का पानी तो बहुत ख़राब है, आप कैसे कह रहे हो आपका पानी अच्छा है. तो कहने लगे साहब यमुना का पानी है, यमुना का पानी है, वहाँ से पानी लेते नहीं, हमारे यहाँ तो बोरिंग है और उसी पानी पे हम हैं, तो हमारी सेहत देखिए उसके बाद बोलिए. तो 400 मीटर दूर पे उसी रेत में जो पानी निकला, वो पानी बिल्कुल पीने लायक था. तो अभी मैं आपको यही कहना चाहता हूँ कि अभी जो ये जैसे पिछला सवाल आया ना कि सैंड माइनिंग से कितना नुकसान हो रहा है, तमिलनाडु में तो सबसे ज़्यादा नुकसान हो रहा है. वहाँ तो आधी फ्लड प्लेन खा गए हैं पूरी, और अब क्या होगा कि उनके पास जब पानी नहीं रहेगा तो आप ये कर सकते हैं कि कम से कम 300-400 शहरों में ये लागू कर सकता है। सिर्फ ये गंगा बेसन में यहाँ से लेके पूरा कलकत्ते तक कम से कम 250 से शहर हैं जहाँ पे ये आप ऐसा पानी कर सकते हो। तो सब जगह ये हो सकता है जहाँ पे नदी हो, और कोई कोई ऐसी भी जगह है जहाँ पे सीज़न की बारिश होती है सिर्फ, और वो पर ये जमा हो जाता है। पर वो पानी जो है आपको ज़रा ख्याल से उतना ही निकालना चाहिए जितना पानी जमा होता है। जो आप ज़्यादा निकालोगे तो वो पानी वहाँ का ख़त्म हो जाएगा और बाहर से खारा पानी जो है कंटेमिनेटेड वाटर वो आ जाएगा।
रिस्पेक्टेड सर, मेरा सवाल ये है कि हम बिल्कुल दिल्ली के करीब हैं, दिल्ली से सिर्फ 70 किलोमीटर के जगह पे हरियाणा में एक जगह मेवात जो अभी नया डिस्ट्रिक्ट बनाया 6-7 साल पहले, साइबर सिटी में ज़मीन के रेट 50,000 और 1,00,000 तक हैं। उसी से ठीक 25 किलोमीटर आगे जाके पानी है, लेकिन जो अरावली पहाड़ी की जो वैली है उसी के एक्वाफायर वाटर ही है केवल, और वहीं से शहर को पीने का पानी मिलता है। लेटेस्टली वहाँ पे मेडिकल कॉलेज बनाया गया और इंजीनियरिंग कॉलेज भी डेवलप किया गया, और जो जामिया से ही हैं श्री मुन्ना खान करके हैं जो उसके चांसलर वहाँ पे प्रोफेसर हैं। लेकिन सबसे बड़ी समस्या सर वहाँ पे ये है कि वहाँ का पानी इतना साल्टी है, इतना सैलाइन है कि वहाँ से मकान भी नहीं बना सकते वो, और उस पानी को भी परचेज करना पड़ता है वहाँ से, जो ट्रैक्टर की बना रखे उन्होंने ट्रॉलर टाइप, और उससे ला के पानी डालते हैं जिसकी कॉस्ट 500 रुपये लगभग होती है। तो वहाँ पे जो साल्टी वाटर है उस पर हम किस तरह काम कर सकते हैं? और मैं तो इनवाइट करता हूँ सर आपको, क्योंकि बहुत करीब है, केवल दिल्ली से 2 घंटे का रास्ता है, बिल्कुल अच्छा रोड है, तो आप आके वहाँ पे कुछ ऐसा काम करें जो साल्टी वाटर है उसको किसी तरह प्योरीफाई किया जाए और लोगों की जो समस्याएं हैं उनसे उनको दूर किया जाए। क्योंकि वहाँ पर जो एजुकेशन रेशियो है वो भी काफ़ी कम है, और 75% जो पॉपुलेशन है वो मोमडन है, मेयो एक कम्युनिटी है वहाँ की, और जो बहुत ज़्यादा लिटरेसी रेट बहुत ज़्यादा हाई नहीं है। तो हम चाहते हैं सर आप वहाँ आएँ और इस साल्टी वाटर के ऊपर कुछ सजेशंस दें।
नहीं, मैं तो आ जाऊँगा पर पानी सही नहीं होगा। देखिए ऐसा है
जी
कि एक बार आपका पानी खारा हो जाए या सॉल्टी हो जाए या कंटेमिनेट हो जाए तब आप उसे नहीं साफ कर सकते हैं। यही कर सकते हैं आरो, और कोई तरीका नहीं है। देखिए इसीलिए मैं आपसे कह रहा हूँ कि वहाँ क्या हुआ है कि लोग जब ज़्यादा पानी निकाल लेते हैं, जितना आपको कुदरत देती है उससे ज़्यादा पानी आप निकाल लो तो बाहर के पानी आ जाते हैं, जो खारे पानी हो या ख़राब पानी हो। एक बार वो वहाँ पे आ गए तब आप उसका कुछ नहीं कर सकते, या तो उस पानी को पूरे को निकाल दीजिए पर फिर और पानी आ जाएगा। तो अब आपको वहाँ वही डिसैलिनेशन करना पड़ेगा या रिवर्स ऑस्मोसिस, और कोई चारा नहीं है। इसीलिए मेरी तो अर्ज़ ये है कि आप कुदरत का ज़रा ख्याल रखें, कुदरत की कदर करें, और क्योंकि इसी के ऊपर आपका जीवन जो है वो इसी के ऊपर चलता है। तो अब जब वहाँ पे खारा पानी आ गया है तो इसका तो बस यही इलाज है और कुछ नहीं।
लेकिन सर अरावली पहाड़ी की जो किनारे हैं उनके साइड में मीठा पानी है, तो क्या उस पानी के साथ हम उसको किसी तरह डेवलप नहीं कर सकते वहाँ पे, जो बहुत ज़्यादा कोई नदी भी नहीं है आसपास?
देखिए ऐसा है कि ये हो सकता है कि लोकलाइज्ड हो, तो फिर आप आसपास में देखिए जहाँ पे अच्छा पानी है, पर उसका ज़्यादा एक्सप्लॉइट मत करिए। जितना आपको कुदरत देती उतना लीजिए, पर उसके आसपास में कहीं अच्छा पानी भी होगा, सब पानी खारा नहीं होगा।
नहीं, जो अरावली के सर पहाड़ी आती है जो अलवर से लेकर और दिल्ली तक आती है, उसके किनारे किनारे जो वाटर सप्लाई वाले उन्होंने बोर कर रखे हैं, ड्रिल किए हुए हैं, तो वहाँ पे जो ड्रिलिंग है उसमें मीठा पानी है सिर्फ। लेकिन जो 10 किलोमीटर जो केवल लगभग 20-30 फुट पे ही जो पानी है इजीली अवेलेबल है, लेकिन बहुत ज़्यादा साल्टी है। और ये सबसे
मुझे देखिए इसका पूरा इतिहास पता नहीं है कि जो कुदरती भी हो सकता है जियोलॉजिकली।
जी कुदरती है, क्योंकि 20 साल से तो हम देख रहे हैं
कई जगह हैं जहाँ पे जैसे कि बांग्लादेश और बंगाल में आर्सेनिक आ जाता है पानी में, यहाँ पे भी आपका खारा पानी कई जगह हो सकता है। तो हो सकता है आपके पास में कहीं अच्छी जगह हो जहाँ पानी भी ठीक हो, पर उसको ख्याल से इस्तेमाल करें, ज़्यादा नहीं।
लेकिन सर जो साल्टी है इसके ऊपर कोई वर्क अगर है दिल्ली के अंदर तो उसको यहाँ इंट्रोड्यूस किया जाए?
डिसैलिनेशन यही आरओ से ही होता है।
थैंक यू सर।
सर माय नेम इज़ तौसीफ रज़ा और मैं बिहार के कटिहार ज़िले से बिलोंग करता हूँ। सर मैं जिस शहर में बिलोंग से हूँ वहाँ के कई जगहों पर पानी आयरन युक्त है। मैंने कई केस देखा है, जैसे यहाँ पे ट्यूबवेल कोड़ा लगाया गया है, वहाँ से फ्रेश पानी आ रहा है और उसके 2 मीटर के बगल में फिर ट्यूबवेल गाड़ा गया है, वहाँ से आयरन युक्त पानी निकल रहा है, ऐसा क्यों? और मैंने एक और केस देखा है जो मेरे बिल्कुल बगल के घर का है, वहाँ पे कुछ दिन पहले ट्यूबवेल से साफ पानी आ रहा था और ट्यूबवेल खराब हो गई, ट्यूबवेल एक्सचेंज करके उसी जगह पर लगाया गया, फिर वहाँ से आयरन युक्त पानी निकलने लगी, ऐसा सिचुएशन क्यों क्रिएट हुआ?
देखिए, जो ये आयरन आ गया पानी में तो दो वजह हो सकती हैं। एक तो कहीं कहीं कुदरती आसपास में ज़्यादा पानी आप खींच लें तो कहीं आसपास से जो पहले मीठा था कुछ आयरन आ सकता है। अब आयरन आप निकाल तो सकते हैं पर उसमें भी आयरन से इतना नुकसान तो नहीं होता है, होता हो सकता है जो बहुत ज़्यादा हो पर उसका रंग फ़र्क हो जाता है पानी का, यही आप कह रहे ना, उसको फिल्टर भी कर लें तो ठीक हो सकता है। पर दूसरा यही हो सकता है कि या तो कुदरती है, कुदरती नहीं है तो कोई वहाँ पे कारखाना है जो चीज़ें छोड़ रहा है, जैसे कई कारखाने होते हैं जिनका वेस्ट वाटर उसमें आयरन होता है।
सर मेरा जो इलाका है वहाँ पर वो बिल्कुल ही पीपल या वो पूरी तरह से लोगों के बसने के लिए वहाँ पे कोई भी इंडस्ट्री नहीं है, और मेरा क्वेश्चन ये था कि आखिर ये इतना कम डिस्टेंस पर ये फ़र्क क्यों हो गया और उसी जगह पर ट्यूबवेल डालने के बावजूद ऐसा क्यों हो गया जबकि वहाँ पर बहुत ज़्यादा ना ही पानी निकाला जाता है, एक नॉर्मल लोग रहते हैं जिनकी पानी की ज़रूरत भी बहुत ज़्यादा नहीं है जिससे वो ज़्यादा पानी को वेस्ट करे जो ऐसी सिचुएशन क्रिएट हो।
आपका सवाल बिल्कुल सही है पर ये ऐसा होता है कि आप पृथ्वी में देखेंगे कि सब जगह का पानी अच्छा नहीं मिलेगा, कई जगह ऐसे भी होती जहाँ कुदरती पानी में ज़्यादा कुछ मिलावट आ जाती, आर्सेनिक हो जाता है, क्लोराइड हो जाता है, आयरन हो जाता है, फ्लोराइड हो जाता है, और कई चीज़ें हैं कि जो हमारे आदमियों की जो खुराफात है उसकी वजह से पानी आप गंदा कर सकते हैं। आपकी बात से मुझे लग रहा है कि आपके यहाँ पानी जो है ये कुदरती, उसमें आयरन ज़्यादा है।
यस सर, मेरे घर में पानी आयरन युक्त है।
तो उसका तो यही है कि या तो फिल्टर कर लो जो अब मोटा होगा, नहीं होगा तो उसके बाद उसको भी आरो करना पड़ेगा, नहीं तो दूसरी जगह से पानी लाना पड़ेगा, और इस चीज़ का कुछ नहीं कर सकते। कई जगह होता है ऐसा, पर आपको आसपास में और भी कुछ पानी मिल जाएगा जिसमें इतना लोहा नहीं होगा। हाँ, अब मुझे पता नहीं वो कुछ है कि आपका नेक्स्ट प्रोग्राम में देरी नहीं हो रही है, हम तो यहाँ मौजूद हैं, जो किसी को बात करनी है तो बड़ी खुशी से करें।
तो गुड इवनिंग सर।
हाँ नहीं सर, सॉरी, आप पूछिए।
सर मैं सुनील कुमार दिल्ली से हूँ। सर आजकल रेन एसिड रेट में तब्दील होता जा रहा है सर, जिसकी वजह से ताजमहल भी पीता पटना जा रहा है सर, इसको रोकने के लिए क्या किया जा सकता है?
हाँ, एसिड रेन तो ये तो बड़ी इसका तो हल बहुत आसान है। जितने कारखाने हैं उनसे जितना ये निकलता है ये धुआँ, वही एसिड रेन बन के नीचे आता है, तो ये तो कारखानों के ऊपर आपको कानून लगाना पड़ेगा है? जैसे वेस्ट वाटर का, अब हमारे प्रधानमंत्री आजकल ये भी कह रहे हैं कि बहुत कानून ये है कि आप गंदा पानी, गंगा को गंदा नहीं करेंगे और नदियों को गंदा नहीं करेंगे, तो हवा का भी वही हाल है जो पानी का हाल है, तो उन कारखानों पे ये आपको बंदिश, ये उन पे कानून लगाना पड़ेगा कि ये वो बिल्कुल ऐसा जो स्मोक है वो नहीं छोड़ सकें, यही तरीका है।
इसके अलावा दूसरा कुछ तरीका नहीं है?
इसके अलावा और क्या कर सकते हैं आप बताइए, अब ऊपर है, आप अपने आप ही बताओ, आपको पता है कि कुछ निकल रही है दूषित चीज़, तो उसको बंद करने के लिए तो वही कारखाना बंद, या तो बंद करो नहीं तो कारखाने से कहो कि आप ठीक करो अपने को।
थैंक यू सर।